continue to expand His kingdom in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Today we have in our midst the daddy and mommy that visited us, and they decided to come and be a blessing to us. Amen.
Amen.
And we have a pastor, Olusola Adebayo, in our midst. He came from Nigeria. Praise the Lord. And he's the pastor that is in charge of the Kingdom Project, TKP. And I believe you know more about that. I think it's about a project that's consigning of mission work in the whole world, not just in a particular place. In fact, it's part of it that brought him to this place. And I believe that through him we'll be blessed today in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Also with him is the wife, also Pastor Fumi Adebayo.
Hallelujah.
And my prayers that the Lord will continue to keep them, and through them will be blessed in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
It is a time to listen and pay attention, because God is about to do something. Before I invite him, I want you to know, and you know the story very well. When a particular woman that was sick for 12 years with the issue of blood, and the Bible said that as Jesus was moving, so many crowd was touching him. And suddenly Jesus said, somebody has touched me. And the apostle says, what are you trying to say? Everybody's pushing at you left and right, and you are saying somebody touched you. Every almost people that are around you that are touching you. But Jesus said, no, somebody has touched me specially. And lo and behold, the woman came and just spoke to Jesus. The Bible said that she told herself that if I can just touch the hem of his garment, I'll be healed. And she did so. And the Bible said the sickness of the issue of blood for 12 years disappeared, and she was healed instantly. So what am I trying to say? You might be here and you might not be here. Praise the Lord. So many people were touching Jesus, but that woman touched him for special way. Praise the Lord. So I want you, as you are here, let your coming here, let your being here be special. Amen. So that you will be blessed. Amen. You will not be like other crowd that we are touching Jesus, but you will be like that woman that touched Jesus in a special way. And she received her miracle. She received her healing. So here this afternoon, I want you to be like that woman. Be special. And open your heart. Open your mind. And touched Jesus. And I tell you, you will go back home being healed, being blessed in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
So I want you to pay attention as I call our daddy, Pastor Shola Adebayo.
Good morning, brethren.
Good morning.
It's a great joy to fellowship with us here today at the Redeemed Christian Church of God, Bergen. Tomorrow we make it exactly 3 weeks that we arrived here, my wife and myself, primarily to teach in a school of missions. For the past 9 years, we have a sister organization here called Tent Norway, but now Tent International, that we have been relating with. So they carried out a training program early this month in which we happened to be one of the resource persons. So that lasted for a week, and the following week we visited a pastor in worship. Pastor Innocent knows him very well. I'm talking of Pastor Zion.
Godfather.
A friend of close to 30 years now. So from there, we moved on to Sweden to visit another Swedish family, and then back to Bergen for the second leg of our program. So we count it a great privilege spending second to the last day.
Amen.
In Bergen at the Redeemed Christian Church of God. I have been richly blessed, been part of this service today. I thank God for the servant of God who first brought the word, challenging everyone to move from slavery to sonship. I said, that's great. Say, God, let this word accomplish your desire in this service this morning. And I believe God has answered the prayer. And then comes our brother, Pastor Yomi. Am I right?
Brother Yomi.
All right. That I have prophesied it already. And it is established. He brought us the word of the Lord on this very important issue of marriage. Pastor, I thank God for this assembly. Pastor Innocent, I thank God for this assembly. You are set to possess the land. And our faithful God who said, fear not, little flock. That's Luke chapter 12, verse 33. He said, fear not, little flock. It is your Father's pleasure to give you the kingdom. The Lord will demonstrate his faithfulness in this congregation in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
On a daily basis, as it happened in the Acts of the Apostles, their souls were added unto the believers. So God is going to repeat that experience again. In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I have very few minutes to share the word of God with us. And I'll be talking on this very important topic. A correct picture of the future. The summary of what I'll be sharing with us is put into this paper. Our pastor will make it available to us later on. A correct picture of the future. The man of whom we read during the Bible reading, that's Daniel, he got that picture. And that's the reason why Daniel is alive in the heart of so many of us today. Right from the word go, he caught a glimpse of the future. The picture of how the future looks like was so bright in the heart of Daniel. And you know what you are seeing will dictate so many things about your life. So the life of Daniel was different from the word go. When difficulties come, Daniel surmounted it with prayer and faith in God. When prosperity comes, Daniel still maintained his focus on God because he was seeing something that others weren't seeing. And I pray that this morning, the Lord is going to open your eyes.
Amen.
He will anoint your eyes with eyesalves. And will empower you to see and to have a correct picture of the future in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
There is this prayer the psalmist prayed, which we are going to sing just twice. He said, open my eyes, O God, that I may behold wondrous things from your word. You sing it with me just two times as we go into the word of the Lord. Open my eyes, O Lord. I want to see. Open my eyes, O Lord. I will obey. Open my eyes, O Lord. I am ready, ready to obey. Open my eyes of faith. Open my eyes, O Lord. I am praying. Open my that you will anoint the eyes of every one of us in your presence in this house this morning, and cause us to see things the exact way the Lord sees them. Our opportunities today, our land wherein the Lord has put us today, the assignment the Lord has placed in our hands today, our spouses, our children, our church, Lord, open our eyes to see exactly the way you see, and cause faith to arise in us to respond appropriately, to move our service unto you, our worship of your majesty, unto a new level.
Amen.
Thank you, Almighty God. Lord, we trust you that your word will come unto us as a double-edged sword.
Amen.
Every side it goes, it will be making impact.
Amen.
And every one of us will leave this place with specific testimonies.
Amen.
Testimonies of the touch of God, testimonies of revival, testimonies of healing. Specific testimonies.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you, Heavenly Father. Lord, we give you praise.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus Christ, we have prayed.
Amen.
Amen. Please turn your Bible with me to 1 Peter chapter 1. And we read a scripture to us very briefly. 1 Peter chapter 1. And we read verses 24 and 25. 1 Peter chapter 1. Is it projected? All right, thank you. The Bible I'm carrying is fairly new, so the page is one. I agree to hope that it has opened eventually. 1 Peter chapter 1, I read verses 24 and 25. All flesh is as grass, and all the glory of man as the flower of the grass. The grass withers and its flower falls away. But the word of the Lord endures forever. Now, this is the word which by the gospel was preached to you. Amen.
Amen.
I would like to assure you of this very crucial thing, that everything you can see with your physical eyes, no matter how majestic, aircraft, 787 Dreamliner, you know how hefty it is? The biggest of the cruise ships that come to Bergen, you know how huge they are? Some of them carrying 3,000 passengers. The tallest of the buildings around, the wonders of technology, you know? Everything you can see with your physical eyes, all of them are carrying an invisible inscription, an invisible label, and that label says it cannot last forever. It's an invisible label tagged
on everything your physical eyes can see. The labor says it cannot last forever. So when you look at that thing, whether the thing is positive or say that this beautiful positive thing has come my way so I can use it to serve God, while I can do so because it can't last forever. Let me give you an example of the positive things. The Lord suddenly moves you up and you are promoted to become the manager of the bank where you work. That's a positive thing, isn't it? And I pray in the name of Jesus that the testimonies of promotion will become a common thing in the midst of us in the name of Jesus. Amen. But from day one, when you sit on that chair as the manager, open your eyes and see the invisible labor. It cannot last forever. When you see that labor, then you make up your mind that while it lasts, I will use it to serve God. I will use it to bring souls to the kingdom of God. I will use it to advance the kingdom of Christ. I will use it to lay treasures for myself over there in heaven. Then you are becoming another Daniel for our generation. That's why we read the book of Daniel during the Bible reading. Daniel's life, you know, was a mixture of up and down. As a young man, he was taken captive. Nobody wants that. The enemy invaded Israel, and Daniel happened to be one of those that were banned, left and full and feet. I mean, feet and hands and chain in the neck, and were led to Babylon. These are our captives. But on getting there to Babylon, God smiled at him. The Babylonian king said, "Get me some correct, egg-headed, intelligent Hebrew men. I will train them in the university for 3 years. Then they enter into full service in my court." And Daniel was privileged by God to be one of those that were chosen. And Daniel looked right and left that my problems can't last forever. Likewise, my privileges. So from day one, Daniel 1:8, the Bible says Daniel proposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the king's portion. So another Daniel for our generation. We say, "God, thank you for making me, promoting me to become the manager of this bank. I'm not going to defile myself by this opportunity. I will rather serve you and lay up treasures for myself in heaven." But for somebody to do that, you need to have a correct picture of the future. So that when the positive things come, beautiful, you use them to serve the Lord. And if the negative one comes as a result of God wanting to toughen you, to strengthen you, amen, you still take your stand that this one, it will soon pass away. My God can take this problem away today. If he allows it to last today, it is because he is accomplishing something in my life. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So without understanding that, even this thing that looks negative, it carries the labor. It cannot last. It has an expiry date. Thank you, my brother. It has an expiry date. And while it is there, before it expires, I will learn all my lessons. I will flex my spiritual muscle and allow God to bring me out of this thing a better Christian, a better believer, a better servant of the Most High God. As we are sharing this together today, I will want every one of us to just look around us, whatever it is that God has surrounded you with, and say, God, give me a correct picture of this thing that you have placed in my hand. When the Lord does that, this is what it is going to do for you. Number one, your love for God will multiply. Number two, nothing will become an idol to you. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
When the pastor says, "Oh, workers report here by 11, no matter how so much you love football, that football will not become an idol. You will ensure you are here by 11. As you look around, whatever it is that God has endowed upon you today, when you have a correct picture of the future of that thing, you will love God more, and nothing will become an idol to you. This thing we are sharing today helps us to understand better 1 John chapter 2, verse 15 to 17. It says, "Do not love the world, neither the things that are in the world." That's verse 15. "Because the things you find in the world, the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life, they are not of the Father." Now verse 17 says something. It says, "But the world passeth away." Look at it on the board. Thank you for projecting it. Can we chorus it together? One, two, go.
"And the world passeth away, and the lust thereof. But he that dwelleth with the Lord abideth forever."
Amen.
Amen.
The world is passing away, and everything thereof. It's only he that doeth the will of God that will abide forever. Let me just give you a beautiful example of what that scripture is saying. Anyone in this service today who is, let's say, above 35, 40 years old, cast your mind back. The possessions you had 30 years ago, suit, shoe, car, 30 years ago. What do those things amount to today?
Nothing.
The car you are riding 30 years ago, you will be ashamed to put them on the street of Bergen or Lagos or wherever 30 years ago. I think that time we still have Peugeot 404 in Nigeria. Very rugged.
Ijapa,
thank you. Me too. Also very rugged. I was talking with a friend of mine in my 200 level in UI. I said, "Wow, God, if you just give me 404 for the mission work you are calling me into, we'll go places for you. If he gives me 404 that I saw, that's almost 30 years ago today." So 30 years ago, the things you have that time, it's like all of them with the lost, they are rough, they are passed away. And look at 30 years to come. If there will be anything today that will rob somebody of serving God and being your best for God, 30 years to come, those things also will do what? Pass away with the lost thereof. The only person that abides forever is the one that doeth the will of the Lord. Oh, may the Lord open your eyes today.
Amen.
In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. The things that are making many people to fall away from the faith, the things that are making many people to think that correct Christianity is not practicable all over the world. How will you be in the city of Bergen, New York, Oslo, As if he a correct Christian, come on, it's difficult. Let's be practical. That's the lie of the devil. All those things that are blindfolding the enemy, they won't last forever. If the Lord helps you to see the future of those things, oh, you will cry unto God and you will labor to be whom the Lord wants you to be. We understand that Esau lost his birthright because he could not see beyond this. No, he said, of what use is this? I said, I'm hungry. Come on, give me porridge. And you know the same tactic the devil is using for many people today. Hey, I'm 30-something, no husband yet. And this guy said he wants to marry me, and you are saying he's smoking. Abba, who tells you won't stop the smoking later on? Come on. Don't lose your birthright because of the guy that you see today and you actually don't know his future. And you want to throw away your birthright like that. A correct picture of the future will help you to say no. I will protect my birthright. I'm not going to be unequally yoked with an unbeliever. I will see beyond my trouble. I will see beyond my needs. I will see beyond the cry of the flesh today. I will look into the end of the tunnel. There is light there. And I will hold on to this Jesus. I will walk with him. I will serve him. I will love him more and more every day. I'm not just looking at now. I'm looking at tomorrow. I'm looking at the future. A correct picture of the future keeps you in shape all the days of your life. A correct picture of the future helps you to place your priority well in life. A correct picture of the future makes you the kind of prayer warrior the Lord wants you to be. Because when the pastor says, let's pray for Bergen, that there will be a great revival. Someone who is blind will say, what is the pastor saying? Come on, let's shift gear and pray that those of us, you know, who are riding one car today, it will become four. Those of us who are counting the figures in six today will begin to count it in seven. That is good and correct. But please, the correct picture of the future will make you also to go wild in prayer when it comes to praying for this city. Jesus Christ quoted the book of Psalm for his disciple. And let me also quote that to you so that it can set you ablaze in laboring for the kingdom of God. And that's Isaiah chapter 9 from verse 1 to 2. Jesus quoted it in Matthew chapter 4 verse 16. He said, nevertheless, the dimness shall not be such as was in our vexation. When at the first time he lightly afflicted the land of Zebulun and land of Naphtali, and afterwards did more grievously afflict her by the way of the sea beyond Jordan in Galilee of the nations. Now, the people that walked in darkness have seen a great light. Amen. They that dwell in the land of the shadow of death, upon them at the light shine. That's what the Lord is going to do in Bergen. Because the Lord puts you in this city not by accident, for a purpose. And if you can just see what Jesus saw, Isaiah prophesied this several hundreds of years before our Lord Jesus was born in a manger. And Jesus Christ looked around himself at the beginning of his earthly ministry in Matthew chapter 4 verse 16. And he said, hey, the people that walk in darkness, they are going to see a great light. Those who are dwelling in the shadow of the region of death, light will spring unto them. And the next verse, verse 17, the Bible says, from that time onward, Jesus began to preach, saying, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. He saw something. That these people you are seeing around today, God has not closed their chapters. The one puffing cigarette, the one doing cohabitation. I know you've heard about what is called cohabitation, Abby. The one doing gay marriage and all the rubbish. God has not closed their chapter. He still wants to reach out to them. He wants to bring them to his kingdom. He wants to deliver them from the shackles of sin. That was what Jesus saw. And the Bible says, from that moment, Matthew 4, 17, he began to preach. I was excited when I learned that. The last national day, you are there with the church flag, marched with them, proclaiming the lordship of Jesus. I said, that's beautiful. We need it. Our land need it. But it will take somebody seeing Jesus, somebody seeing the direction our Lord Jesus is going to be able to do that. When they say, let's give for mission, somebody who is having the correct picture of the future will not say, why should we bother ourselves about mission fields when we still have so much around us? Yeah, the correct picture of the future. This is one thing I've prayed for, which I'm still praying right now. The Lord is going to anoint our eyes with eye salves. Day and night, we set the Lord always before us. And because he is at our right hand, we shall not be moved. What the Lord sees about our congregation, we will see it. Amen.
Amen.
Very soon, all these seats shall be occupied.
Amen.
By living souls, living souls, living souls. And as you say that on a daily basis, an individual will say, Lord, next Sunday, I must come with somebody to this church. And because God honors such prayer, right from Monday, he began to orchestrate opportunity to work upon somebody. And eventually, by next Sunday, someone is sitting beside you whom you labored over and brought to the house of God. And as you are doing that, my beloved brother Williams is doing the same thing. My sister, my brother, everybody is doing that because we are seeing the correct picture of something that looked like the fruit of mustard seed today. And so everybody is busy laboring that the purpose of God might be accomplished. The Lord God Almighty will accomplish his purpose in your life. And through your life, accomplish his purpose in Bergen. Accomplish his purpose in Norway.
Amen.
Accomplish his purpose in our generation.
Amen.
In the name of the Lord Jesus.
Amen.
And as I close, let me give you this assurance. That when the Lord grants you the correct picture of the future, and you live by that picture all the days of your life, listen carefully, nothing can stop you from getting to the pinnacle God has prepared for your life. Amen.
Amen.
Examples are all over the Bible. And that same God, because he is the same yesterday, today, and forever, will prove himself faithful in your life. In the name of the Lord Jesus.
Amen.
Nothing can stop you. Nothing is going to stop you from getting to the pinnacle that God has prepared for your life. Because you are seeing the invisible
so you will continue to do what men call impossible. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. The forces that are making others to say there is a casting down, they will rather make you to say there is a lifting up. In the name of the Lord Jesus. The forces that are giving crutches to other people, do you know what it's going to do to you? It will give you wings. In the name of the Lord Jesus. Where people are stagnant, you will be progressing.
Amen.
Where people are crawling and walking, you will be flying.
Amen.
In the name of the Lord Jesus.
Amen.
I want us to rise on our feet as we conclude this sharing with a very short period of prayer. You are going to lift your hands to God and say, God, anoint my eyes with eyesight. That everything around me today, men around me, the privileges around me, the seeming problem around me, whatever it is around me, today, I will see them the way you see them. I will maximize those things for the glory of God, for the advancement of the kingdom of Christ. For the blessings of my generation and the church of God. Lord, anoint my eyes with eyesight. That I might see correctly, that I might run correctly, that I might live correctly, that I might labor correctly. And that I might enjoy this living God also. Enjoy divine possibility. Enjoy the grace of God. Enjoy the power of God. In the name of the Lord Jesus, that I might become another Daniel for my generation. That unstoppable professional, that unstoppable pastor, that unstoppable son of the Most High, that unstoppable servant of the Most High. God, make me another Daniel for my generation. In the name of Jesus. Oh, thank you, Heavenly Father. Lord, we worship. Let's bring our prayer to a close as we worship the Lord together with this song. I praise you. I praise you.